Thank you for having me here. Not so long back, just 5 years ago, Indian banks were talking about whether family office as a concept would be relevant to Indian families. And when we say what private bankers and what corporate bankers would talk about in that context would mean, does it make sense to run a business called family office? Barring top 10, top 20 Indian families who had traditionally single family offices of their own, which my previous speakers have very well articulated what a single family office is about. For the balanced families in India, does it make sense to even have a family office? So not so long back, we were all debating that in India, and many ventured in the space and rolled back. And 5 years from then, today we are having the first family office summit, and I think it gives me great pleasure to see this happening. And it really marks the need for Indian families to have a family office set up, whether single or multi. So what I'm going to give you here is a flavor of Indian families. And I want to call Indian families as global Indian families today, because none of the families are not global. So what I'm going to talk about will be a direct experience of what these Indian global families have to deal with, what they need, and how their issues are currently getting addressed, and what is the potential in the future. So I'm going to talk about what's a global Indian family, the consequences of not having a succession plan, the need for succession planning in India, personal and corporate succession structures in India, which are currently in practice, and key points to consider for a family when they plan succession, as well as what is the role of trustees in this succession planning space. Well, this is an interesting slide. India tops the world in family feuds over family wealth. If you look at India's contribution, 61% feel that India tops the world in that. And does that mean that since India did not have succession planning in place, were there not enough motivation to set up structures in India? Or was it just the absence of inheritance taxes that India remained almost devoid of any succession planning? So why developing and sustaining family business has been a challenge in India? So most families do not survive more than 2-3 generations in terms of the family business. Later generations are born into prosperity, and hence they assume it is permanent. The next generation either gets inducted as managers, often at senior levels, not aware of the nuances of business, like the first generation members who actually built it from scratch. Of course, they do not recognize the rapidly changing environment. There is absolutely no family level agreement in most of the families we talk to for want of adequate exposure or orientation or any deciding criteria. And future exigencies, more often than not, are often left to chance. No criteria for future decision making on family or even business issues. In fact, I was talking to a family the other day, and I found it a little funny when the family business owner, who's a first-generation entrepreneur, actually said that his two daughters, aged 7 and 12, and both of them want succession planning. So what we're planning to do is to divide the company vertically, create another entity, give one company to one daughter and another to another. So that was a little funny, coming from the idea of succession people have and how they would like to push decision making into the future and let it be subject to so much of external exigency. That's the level where the orientation, the education on succession that Indian families very well deserve today. And every family, of course, believes, you know, nothing of the sort can happen to us, so, you know, we're going to be like this forever. Barbara and Richard spoke about shirt sleeves to shirt sleeves. I think it is only better that we are talking so much about it, because this area needs to be addressed very, very critically in this country. Look at the past and the present of the business families in India. Approximately 70% of all listed companies, I think this is something that we all know, 70% of the companies listed on the stock exchange are family-owned. The demerger of business families with trauma and acrimony is fairly common in India, and I think there have been glaring public examples of that. Traditionally in India, whether it is the throne or the family business, the eldest child has always been the successor. In fact, when we were talking to a lot of international family offices trying to figure out was there an area of collaboration with international family offices to give Indian families a suitable family office, it just did not work because Indian families are so distinct from Western families, there cannot be a cut-paste job of pasting an international family office in India. So Indian family offices really have to work from scratch, understand the Indian family behavior, and then take it up from there. For reasons as simple as this, the eldest child is always the successor, more often than not, actually. So some business families divided their businesses vertically in the past, with different companies going to different factions of the family, and that was not necessarily viable for the business or for even smooth succession of assets. Reliance Industries, Bajaj Auto, Escorts, Modi Group, PCM Shriram, and Bhushan Steel are glaring examples of that. So what happens if you do not have a succession plan? So in India, if a person dies interstate, his wealth gets divided among his natural heirs based on the person's succession laws. So businesses built over generations typically may split unless the heirs continue to work together. Businesses may pass over to a person who does not have the right skill sets. Decision making becomes difficult and family conflicts arise. There is great uncertainty on business growth, negative impact on the brand and reputation, and of course, there is great uncertainty for any stakeholder, whether employees, investors, vendors, and customers. And of course, all of us know Indian judicial system is not very conducive for transfer of assets, and hence legal heirs may have to go through long drawn out legal battles to claim their rights. So what does a high net worth individual or family basically is worried about? So they say, all my wealth is in business. Because every time, if you really see a lot of Indian families, even the dividends are not declared and that wealth gets plowed back into the business. So all the wealth is in the business. And what happens in such scenarios? Then the business gets into troubled waters, event of split with the spouse or within the joint family. And what happens to a business post-lifetime? The next concern would be, how do I finance and retain control over my wealth, whether it is in business or personal assets? How do I induct the generation next into the business? What is the scenario when generation next actually does not live up to the expectations? And that happens more often than not. Passing the baton is a very critical area for Indian business houses. Scenario when children are not interested to be active in the business, they want to be, they want to be an artist, or they want to do farming, or they want to just get into private equity. What happens then? And then, of course, how to provide for upkeep of future generations, education, marriage of children, and how to pass on this wealth ultimately to the next generation. So these are the basic concerns that Indian families actually need, some amount of advice for. And when you talk about India specifics, it's very clear that the safety concerns are up like a writing on the wall. Our judicial and legal framework is certainly not conducive for speedy resolution. Intergenerational transfers are not planned systematically, and hence the lack of uniform laws makes it all the more difficult to manage not just Indian assets but also geographically diverse assets. So here are some facts about the HNI mindset, and some of which may vary from Indian HNIs. So values are passed down from parents. Indian HNIs, 74% believe that, and global HNIs, the number is a little less, about 59%. 99% HNIs in India believe that assets should be passed on to the next generation. I think one of the speakers pointed that out as well. 40% of global HNIs have personal experience of family wealth leading to conflicts by wealth as well as income levels. 35% of global HNIs do not trust their children to protect their inheritance, which is like more outside India if we were to talk about families in the West, which means developed countries displayed higher level of uncertainty while trusting their children in this space. And then of course 57%, like half of the HNI population in the world, believes that succession planning is important. So if you look at how Asia is placed, 61% of Asian HNIs now believe that they need professional advice for inheritance planning. And some examples of large families who have had succession planning in, place. Of course, if you look at the global Western families, right from Ford, Marriott, Cargill, Perrier, Heineken, all have had very, very clear succession planning structures, family offices there for decades. And when you look at Indian families, some of the Indian families have done a great job, and I think GMR and Murugappa Group are clear examples. Dabur, Dr. Reddy's have recently done their succession planning, and I believe the regulators have also given a go-ahead. So clearly, most large business houses today cannot ignore the need for succession planning. And of course, I mean, being in this space for very long, we now see a large number of senior management professionals, owners of small and medium businesses, coming out and asking for a sort of a portion of a family office, if not, because a lot of times affording a single family office is not possible, and hence there's need for giving them a family office advisory out of a multi-family office, which can suit their, which can be cost effective to them. So key objectives of succession planning would be structured planning for family and business assets, which means that we have to really look at business assets and personal assets in togetherness and try to figure out that personal succession and business succession should be laid out very, very clearly for all the family members. Consolidation of family assets under one long-term legally sound structure is very, very critical. When we talk to families, typically the first issue that arises is consolidation, because in India, a lot of lawyers and tax consultants advise families to sort of set up new companies every time you acquire an asset. That may not be a very, very viable idea for the future, because consolidation itself can be very, very cost prohibitive. If it comes to that, we have seen families with as high as 80 income tax files, consolidating them, which means 80 different entities filing taxes for different assets. Consolidating them can be really, really challenging. Welfare and maintenance of family members and seamless distribution of control and assets to the next generation. Ensuring that control of the family business remains within the family for many generations to come. Planning for unforeseen eventualities. How do you do that in India? You know, it's very, I mean, we all know about insurance, but how do you plan for unforeseen eventualities when it comes to your own next generation? Avoidance of future family disputes, growing family assets under proper structure, ensuring minimal administrative work for family members, development of a family constitution and code of conduct to preserve family values for all future generations. So some of the traditional tools and the new tools which are being used in India for succession planning are, for example, the will. I don't know how many people in the room have a will. Well, sounds like less than 5%, Aditya. I think if the number here is maybe, what, 200-300? Yeah, I saw only 10 hands. So that's actually the reality, you know, that we have not really even focused about writing a will, because we believe that our assets are not substantial enough, Or we feel that, you know, some of the genuine cases, they feel, okay, one child, so everything will go to that child. So we've really not focused on even a very simple tool of planning succession. And the sad part about wills is that if it gets contested in our country, it can really go into a long drawn out battle. So certainly not advisable for larger families, families with complex structures, families with business assets, across geographies, families which are already into multi-generation with different children into businesses, different children not into businesses. And like I said, wills can lead to fragmentation. Trusts are, we would say, superior tools for planning succession these days. Of course, because of absence of inheritance taxes in India, this was never used as a tool or sort of like in the West, the genesis of having trusts has been sort of minimization of these inheritance taxes. Indians never had the need to do that before 83. So the trust concept has been new for India. And the motivation has been mainly succession planning. So what does a trust route give the family? One of the things that people may not know about is that if you structure a trust well, it can give the family even bankruptcy remoteness. Flexibility to cover future generation beneficiaries provides confidentiality because the structures are private family trusts. And gives adequate control over assets. So what we're trying to say here is that whenever I go and speak somewhere, when anybody talks about trust in India, and Barbara would be surprised that trust in India actually means charitable trust. So the common parlance in India when somebody says trust means something to do with charity. That has been the level of orientation that we've had over the years. However, when we talk about the trust route here, we are talking about private family trusts, which unless written in the trust deed, will not have anything to do with charity. Of course, these trusts are now great tools to help create philanthropic structures for families. And of course, family governance. I would say any family which goes through the first two routes first, can think about creating family governance structures. But before doing that, the first two routes are very, very important for any family. So I'm just going to give you an illustration to just give you a broad idea, because sometimes it's really complex to understand what the trust structure is like. So somebody, Mr. A, aged 55 years, has the following assets in India. And I'm only going to talk about Indian assets right now because of restrictions on the capital account. To invest outside, currently it is only $200,000 per individual. So a family of five can do $1 million per annum, but we do not allow free flow of assets outside India as of now. So if Mr. A has real estate of 40 crores and financial assets of about 30, shares held through an investment company about 15 crores, well, you know, 15 crores would roughly be about 3 million US. So the objective of the family would be to create an optimum cost structure to transfer assets to the next generation, along with long-term administration in India. So the family tree of Mr. A is like this. So he is Indian resident. His wife is also Indian resident. And why I'm using the words Indian resident or non-residents is critical from tax perspective. Barbara mentioned FATCA. I think that's one big area which global Indian families are so worried about today, and we get almost a call on this every third day, how to manage US assets, especially if you're green card holders or US citizens. So Mr. A, with one daughter who's non-resident and two sons, one resident, one non-resident, one son is married with two sons. So he has 3 generations in his family tree already. Simple structure that can be provided for him is that Mr. A settles his assets into a family trust and creates beneficiaries who are his, who are himself, his daughter, his 2 sons, and in fact can even go ahead and create a sub-trust for his grandchildren. And this trust, which is a private trust under the Indian Trust Act, can take all kinds of family assets. One has to see if one would like to transfer real estate into this because of stamp duty implications, which can be prohibitive. Different states levy stamp duties upwards of 5% on the value of assets. So one has to really see that. Another structure I'd like to talk about is a business family where 4 brothers are working together in the business, and 8 second generation family members have already entered the business or are planning to enter. And the family members hold the shares of the operating companies and investment companies in different ratios. And the family wealth in operating companies, as well as real estate and other investment companies across India through various investment companies. So how do you create a structure to transfer assets optimally? So this is the family tree. So creating a succession plan for personal assets could be as simple as this: transfer all assets into a master trust and create 3 sub-trusts for each of the brothers and their families. So this structure can actually go down to even the 3rd generation, because trusts enjoy a pass-through status in India. Let's talk about the corporate succession here. So the settlers, which is going to be the 3 brothers who are holding the shares of the operating companies, can settle these shares into a trust and create beneficiaries of these shares as a next level of the structure. The trustee would actually take advice on any of the decisions relating to being a majority shareholder in the companies from an advisory board. The advisory board could constitute of the promoters, external experts, independent advisors, other family members based on predefined criteria. So basically what we're trying to do here is to separate ownership from management, which is very critical in Indian businesses, as we have seen internationally, that unless family members feel that their ownership rights are protected, no matter who the next CEO in the company is, it would invariably lead to conflict. So separation of ownership and management is very, very critical for future generations, because one does not know whether the next generation would be as skillful to run the business as the first generation was. This structure would not interfere with the day-to-day operations of the company. It's only a holding structure. It can manage entry and exit of family members in the business very, very effectively. It can actually avoid any hostile takeovers in the future. It can carry rights of first refusal in case one of the units in the family wants to exit. And then, of course, it allows professional management. It need not be the family members running the show for generations. You can induct non-family CEOs into the business without affecting the control. And then, of course, the advisory board would take all key decisions affecting the trust assets, which would mean the succession of the CEO, any merger acquisition, business exit, and other issues. And then, of course, the relationship with the company board would be in terms of voting rights and appointment of nominee directors. So after that flavor, I would like to point out some of the legal and tax challenges which have to be addressed through active professional advice. Indian trust laws are developing and will continue. Stamp duty implications have to be considered before transferring any assets into the structures. Companies Act compliances have to be taken care of very, very carefully. In case the companies are listed, then SEBI takeover code may get attracted, and hence the advisors have to work with the regulators to get those exemptions. Exchange control regulations would apply. Taxation aspects of revocable and irrevocable trust structures are different. And of course, you know, what happens if the inheritance tax comes back? Does that make the structure tax efficient? For non-resident Indians, typically they would need to declare Indian assets to their respective jurisdiction. Compliance with tax filing requirements of the respective jurisdiction is important. Combining an offshore trust planning with Indian trust planning would require, you know, constant watch on the limits that RBI, you know, continues to relax. Currently, it is about $1 million per annum when it comes to transfer of assets to offshore beneficiaries. And of course, one needs to consider the different residential status of different family members in case of such structures, as well as tax implications in the US. So how could a trustee assist in such succession planning? One is advise and implement appropriate structure. That could be through trusts, could be through family MOUs, could be through a combination of this and wills, custody and executorship. Annual administration of assets, including day-to-day operations like bank management, expense management, coordination with various investment managers, auditors, accountants, tax and legal counsel. Tax and compliance services mean fund accounting, audit, preparation, filing of tax returns, payment of taxes in India, representation to tax authorities if required. And of course, any value-added services like real estate administration, documentation, document preservation, custody. These are day-to-day operations that a skillful trustee should be able to provide to the families. So that's about it, and thank you for giving me a patient listening. Okay.